Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Care for Rare webinar series. These webinar series to our sponsor LifeCell or Organization for Rare Disease. To bring the patients and discuss we have our he is basically a medical doctor, and after his medical degree he pursued a PhD in basic sciences, and after in Europe. And he has won several national and international awards. Sandeep is going to talk us about premature stop codon mutations and how to develop therapeutics for premature stop codon mutations, which are very, very important for rare diseases. Sandeep, welcome to the Care for Rare Disease.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Sudhindra. I'd like to thank the office bearers of ORD for arranging this. And let me share my slide with you. Can you all see my slide, the first slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can I start?
Yes, sir, please.
Okay. Okay. So thanks. Thank you all for coming for this talk. Please feel free to stop me anytime if you have any kind of doubt. Try to keep this informal so that there will be discussions rather than one person speaking on to a screen. Okay, so today I'm going to talk about a phenomenon called translation read-through and how this phenomenon can be applied to treat certain genetic conditions. Okay, so let me start with the introduction to the molecular, the one major aspect of molecular biology or the central dogma of molecular biology, that is translation. So as you all know, the DNA is transcribed into mRNA and the mRNA is translated into protein. Okay, this process is known as translation, and my entire talk revolves around this process, that is translation. So that's why it's very important to understand some basics of translation. Let me introduce this to you. I'm sure all of you have studied this, but many of you have forgotten. The translation starts on an mRNA with at the start codon and ends when the ribosomes, which are the macromolecular complexes that perform translation, when they encounter a stop codon. Okay, and the genetic information is present on an mRNA in the form of codons. So codons, there are 64 codons because there are four nucleotides and each codon is a triplet, so it forms 64 arrangements or combinations. Out of them, 61 codons code for a certain amino acid, but three of them do not code for any amino acids. They code for they signal termination of translation, so which are shown in red here: UAK, UAG, UGE, and UGG. Sorry, UGA. So these three stop codons are important for my talk because that is the central theme of my talk. And we know this genetic code because of the hard and intelligent work of these people, especially Harvin Khurana and Marshall Muhlenberg. So they deciphered the genetic code in 1960s. So what happens during translation? So the ribosomes, the mRNA ribosomes latch onto the mRNA, and during translation they read the codon by codon. And whenever a codon, when I say codon, it's a triplet of nucleotides. So this codon is recognized by the anticodon, which is present on tRNAs. These tRNAs are transfer RNA, carry specific amino acids on them, and they bring these they translate the codon information into amino acid information on the ribosomes. So that's how the protein synthesis continues. But when this codon when the ribosomes come across the stop codon, one of these three stop codon, there is no transfer RNA which can recognize the stop codon. So only the proteins like release factors recognize that, and this is an indication for ribosomes to terminate the translation. The ribosomes disengage from the mRNA and they are recycled back to a fresh round of translation. Okay. So having said that, let me introduce you to mutations. I'm sure all of you have heard of this term. Mutations is a heritable genetic change. There are three types of mutations. Silent mutations, there is a genetic change, but you don't see any amino acid change. For example, GCC, if it is mutated to GCT, both of them code for alanine. So that's how phenotypically most of the time they are silent. That's why they're known as silent mutations. And there is another kind of mutation called missense mutation. In this, a codon, for example, here, the TGC codes for cysteine. When it gets mutated to GGC, it codes for arginine. So there is a change in both nucleotide sequence as well as amino acid sequence. And this may or may not result in a disease condition. And the contrary, in the nonsense mutations, you usually have a dramatic phenotype. In this case example, for example, TGC, when it gets mutated to TGA, so instead of coding for cysteine, it signals for the termination of the translation. So the corresponding protein is not made, and there will be a disease phenotype in most cases. So what I have told so far is normally there is a start codon and stop codon in the mRNA. Translation stops here, but whenever there is a nonsense mutation, you come across premature stop codon, and this causes certain kind of genetic diseases. About 11% of all genetic diseases are caused by these nonsense mutations. There are plenty of examples: thalassemia, hemophilia, DMD, Usher syndrome, Rett syndrome. So the list goes on. So here I'm giving one example of HBB mRNA that codes for human beta globin. This is the entire sequence of human HBB mRNA. In the red square, you see the start codon, which is ATG, and the end, you see TAA, another red square, which is the stop codon. But in certain patients, certain people, on the 16th codon, which is TGG, it gets mutated to TGA, which is a stop codon, and those people will have disease condition. This condition is known as beta thalassemia. So beta thalassemia, because of this premature stop codon, I'm giving a so there will be deficiency of beta globin.
Yes, sir, it's muted.
Sorry about that. So in beta thalassemia, you find the deficiency of beta globin because of the premature stop codon. There could be other mutations like frame shift mutations, insertion deletions, etc. And so the India has significant population of thalassemia patients, so it's an important disease. And the patients will have severe anemia because of beta globin deficiency. At present, repeated blood transfusions and bone marrow transplantations are the only treatment options available. Okay, so DMD or Duchenne muscular dystrophy is another condition. In this condition, the nonsense mutation is found in a gene called DMD, and this encodes for a protein called dystrophin, which is an important anchor protein. So this is important for the regeneration of muscles. In the absence of fully functional dystrophin, the muscles cannot regenerate whenever there is injury. So there will be progressive muscle degeneration in the patients with age, and it is an excellent recessive disorder. One more example, well-known example is hemophilia. Here, the nonsense mutations are found in two genes, F8 and F9, which code for factor 8 and factor 9, clotting factors. This is also an extent with CVD. So, there are many other examples. All these diseases, the important feature is they have a premature stop codon, the protein, the truncated non-functional proteins are made. And they will benefit from a therapeutic strategy that will induce translation across such premature stop. So that is the aim of one of the major goals of our laboratory, and we are working towards that. So this is what we call as making sense out of nonsense mutations. Already there are strategies available in the field, one of which is in clinical use, that is Ataluren. The commercial name is Translarna. This is a small molecule which belongs to a class of compounds called oxalazoles, and that induces translation breakthrough across the premature stop codon of DMD, which causes muscular dystrophy. This has received a conditional approval for a treatment in European Union, but it is not approved yet in USA. So its efficacy is still not so far. So aminoglycosides are other kind of components. For decades, it is well known that they can induce translation. But the problem with them is they are highly toxic. So remember, for aminoglycosides are antibiotics, and for that purpose, doctors usually prescribe for a week or so. But since these are genetic conditions, the treatment has to be given for most of the time for lifelong. Okay, so the toxic is a primary concern, and these aminoglycosides act by targeting the E-coding center in ribosomes. Third emerging technology is the suppressor tRNAs. Suppressor tRNA. So these are engineered suppressor tRNA. They have an anticodon which can recognize a stop codon as sense codon, and they will be aminoacylated in the cell, and they will code for a certain amino acid in the place of stop codon. That's how they bring the translation read-through in spite of having a premature stop codon. So the problem with this is there is difficult to deliver because tRNAs are large, they have to compete with the endogenous tRNAs for aminoacylation, so they may have very low aminoacylation efficiency. And also, the most importantly, they also target normal stop codons, which can cause unwanted side effects. So thus, there is a need for new drugs or new strategies or new approaches to induce translation breakthrough across disease-causing premature stop codon, which is shown here. And also, another important thing is, so far, there is no drug or an approach which will achieve this with specificity. When I say specificity, means none of the approaches target a given mRNA. They have a potential to target all mRNA and all stop codons. So that can give rise to unwanted side effects and lower efficacy. Okay, so our lab is interested in the development of a better approach with high specificity and high efficacy to achieve translation read-through across premises stop codon. So from now onwards, I will present the results which we obtained in our laboratory at ISC. We are at the Department of Biochemistry, which is celebrating 100 years this year. It was started in 1919, and my laboratory is 5 years old. So I'm going to present some of the work which we did in the last 5 years. Okay, in the first part, I am going to talk about the natural translation breakthrough in a gene called AGO1 and how we obtain clues from this project to develop a novel therapeutic strategy. So AGO1 is a gene which encodes a protein called AGO1, and this protein is important in microRNA mediated gene silencing. MicroRNAs are small RNAs which are loaded onto target mRNA, and they bring down and the AGO1 protein help in targeting this, and they bring down the expression translation of this mRNA. So microRNAs are very important for the viability and function of the cells. If the microRNA pathway is not there, cell will not be viable. So in a bioinformatics screen, I'm not going to the details of the logic behind it. We identified that AGO1 could be a target for natural translation. So one reason is that it has two stop codons which are imprinted to each other. The first stop codon is the standard canonical stop codon where the primary translation stops. But we also saw some indications to show that the translation is progressing beyond this first stop codon to end in the second stop codon. And in this case, potentially there will be a longer isoform, probably with a different function. To test this, we made this construct. In this construct, there is GFP, or a coding sequence of green fluorescent protein, downstream of AGO1 and followed by a part of the 3' API, and there is a stop codon. The idea behind this is the GFP doesn't have its own start codon, so the translation has to start from the AGO1 part. So if there is fluorescence, that means the translation is crossing this stop codon. That means there is translation read. So when we introduced this construct in mammalian cells, we found fluorescent cells which were not present when a negative control was used. So this fluorescence clearly indicates that there is a translation breakthrough across this stop codon. And we also quantified this fluorescence intensity, and we found that the efficiency of translation breakthrough is about 30%, which is a very significant, physiologically significant amount. So we decided to get more evidence for this phenomenon. For that, we analyzed the ribosome profiling data. So the ribosome profiling is a method which identifies the ribosome footprints on different parts of an mRNA. Here, the x-axis shows the mRNA of AGO1, your start codons, two stop codons, and the 3' untranslated regions are indicated. And the y-axis shows the ribosome footprint, which is nothing but a ribosome sequence in a deep sequencing method. You can see the ribosome footprint in the coding sequence, but you don't see anything in the untranslated. So, interestingly, we found ribosome footprints. You can look at the zoomed in picture here. Ribosome footprints between the two stop codons, which indicates that the ribosomes are crossing this stop codon and terminating the second stop codon. So this also favors the translation, our idea of translation on AGO1. Next, we detected by mass spectrometry the proteins or the peptides which is made by the translation region, that is the region between the two stop codons. The sequence of the peptides detected are given here. And the amino acids which are shown in red are the ones which are encoded in the place of stop codon. The one is aspartame and the tyrosine. This is also a direct evidence to show that the translation breakthrough is happening across this of a canonical stop codon. Remember, all these things are, there is no mutations. Whatever I am talking about is a natural translation process. And the information from this we are going to apply in a disease condition. We also detect by Western blot endogenous translation product, which we call AGO1X. X stands for extended isoform. You can see the AGO1X antibody detecting the expected protein, AGO1222. Interestingly, we also found this isoform in multiple mouse organs, brain, especially in the brain, this expression was very high, heart and also skeletal muscle. So showing that this phenomenon is happening in my mouse. So far, what I've shown here is this AGO1 mRNA has two evolutionally conserved stop codons. Normally, translation stops at the first stop codon, but in certain cases, till the second stop codon, and this phenomenon is known as the natural translation breakthrough. So the important thing we want to know, what is the mechanism of translation in this case? Because if we know this mechanism, we can apply it in a disease condition where premature stop codons are present, and we can induce translation breakthrough there with some therapeutic advantages. So when we analyze the sequence between these two stop codons, which are just shown here, this is the sequence between UAG and UGA are the two stop codons, and this is the sequence between them. There are 99 nucleotides between them. We identify a sequence to which a LET7A microRNA normally binds. So LET7A is a microRNA, and it binds certain targets, certain mRNAs, brings down their expression. That's how it controls gene expression at post-transcription level. It's an important microRNA, especially in angiogenesis. Okay, and it was interesting to find this because it was very close to the canonical stop codon. We thought this may have some role in inducing read-through across this canonical stop codon. To test this hypothesis, we mutated this sequence such that LET7A microRNA doesn't bind. So here, the graph shows the assay, translation read-through assay, which is based on luminescence. The previous assay, what I showed, was based on fluorescence. Here I'm showing luminescence-based assay. So instead of GFP, you see here a coding sequence of firefly luciferase. And this enzyme is expressed only if there is translation read-through across the stop codon of AGO1. And you can see in the wild-type sequence, there is a good luciferase activity. But when you mutate the LET7A microRNA binding site, there is a significant reduction in the firefly luciferase activity, showing that LET7A microRNA can promote the translation across the canonical stop codon. We also used microRNA inhibitor, and by Western blot, we observed a decreased translation product, and we overexpressed this microRNA, and we observed increase in the translation product, which is AGO1X. So all of them show that LET7A promotes translation by binding close to the stop codon, close to the first stop codon. And this process ends in the second stop codon, generating a longer isoform called AGO1X. This part of the work we published last year in the journal. In this talk, I'm not going to discuss about the functional significance of this phenomenon because it is not relevant to the theme of the talk today. Briefly, this acts as a microRNA pathway inhibitor, an endogenous microRNA pathway inhibitor, and it does this by competitively inhibiting the RISC complex to bind to the target mRNAs. And the C terminal extension is important for this process. So, are there any questions before I move on to the next?
Sandeep, may I suggest to take the questions in the end?
Okay, that's also fine. Yeah. Okay, so the next part, so we so the first part we got a clue to induce translation retrieval using a microRNA. The next project we were also trying to understand the general regulation of translation retrieval using a mathematical model. So here I'm showing the kinetics of translation retrieval that's happening during the kinetics of ribosomes during translation retrieval. This is the black line represents an mRNA. It has two stop codons, as you see in case of cargo one, and the green structure is an element which normally is responsible for the translation retrieval. The question we are asking is how the translation retrieval is regulated in this particular very highly simplified case. So the ribosome one, the very first ribosome, which comes near the stop codon, it interacts with this the green element and results in translation retrieval. And during that process, it disrupts the green structure because it has to go through that. The green structure is also a part of the mRNA, so it will eventually disrupt the structure. So the second ribosomes, which arise after the first ribosomes, will not encounter that green structure. So it will disengage and it will result in translation termination. So the question we are asking is, what is the next ribosome which will encounter this green structure and induce translation retrieval? So we just denote it as ribosome N. And what are the factors which determine the value of N? So that's the idea we want to, that's the answer we want to get by mathematical model. So it's not very complicated, it's a very simple model. So we take I as the rate of initiation, R as the rate of translation elongation, and the TS is the time required for the reformation of this green element. And by analyzing these things, you can see that the time required for the recruitment of the next ribosome will be 1 by I, and the distance between any two ribosomes will be R by I, and the distance covered in the time when the green structure is reformed is Ts into R. So at the end, the answer what we get is the efficiency of translation retrieval is determined by two factors, the Ts and I. I is the translation initiation, and the Ts is the time required for the element to reform after the first ribosome goes through it. So I we cannot change because the translation initiation rate, if you affect, so there will be global consequences. You will start regulating the entire translation process in the cell. So the only other way we can regulate the translation retrieval is by altering the Ts, that is, the time required for the reformation of this element. Okay, so these are the two clues we got to develop the new therapeutic strategy. From the AGO1 project, we found that a microRNA that can bind to the next stop codon can induce translation retrieval. And from the mathematical model, we found that the translation retrieval can be regulated by modulating the region which is next to the stop codon. So this brings me to the third part of my talk. So we use this clue to develop a method to induce therapeutic induction of translation retrieval across disease causing premature stop codon. Our strategy is to target the region next to the stop codon using antisense oligonucleotides. What I mean by that is, we're going to target this region, the region after the stop codon, using antisense oligonucleotides. For those who don't remember what is antisense oligonucleotides, so this slide gives a brief introduction. Oligonucleotides are short DNA or RNA or modified oligonucleotides. It could be a morpholino, it could be a lock nucleic acid, it could be a peptidic nucleic acid. So there are DNA and RNA are the natural oligonucleotides. There are also synthetic oligonucleotides, which are more stable and which are more therapeutically advantageous. So the antisense oligonucleotides target a certain sense strand in an opposite orientation, and they attach to those that strand by the quite simple base pair, so A to T and D to C, etc. So these are known as antisense oligonucleotides. And antisense oligonucleotides are widely used in molecular biology. For example, you can block the translation. For example, if you target initiation site or ribosome binding site near the ATG, you can block the translation. You can also degrade the mRNA because when the RNA binds to DNA, it forms RNA-DNA hybrid, and RNA's H enzymes will kill that RNA. And the most important use of this is to cause skipping, exon skipping. So if you remember, during alternative splicing, certain exons are included or excluded, and that generates multiple isoforms on a given gene. For example, in this case, exon 2 can be included or excluded from the mRNA, and this is determined by some splicing factors. And the oligonucleotides can induce or inhibit the inclusion or exclusion of certain exons. This is a therapeutically very relevant function of oligonucleotide. I will move by the next slide. So the antisense oligonucleotides are also used clinically. I am giving you two examples. One is Spinraza, the chemical name is nusinersen. It is an antisense oligonucleotide which causes a similar exon skipping in a gene called SMN1. So in the disease spinal muscular atrophy, the SMN1 gene is mutated, and that causes premature stop codon. But if you induce exon skipping, for example, if the exon 2 has a premature stop codon, and if you exclude exon 2 from the final mRNA, you will not have premature stop codon, and you get human protein. And it is not translation rate, remember, this is just exon skipping. And this is very successful drug. This month, you can see the date here, August 13th, FDA approved another drug called Vitelorsen for DMD, or Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Here, the antisense oligonucleotide is morpholino-based, and here it influences the skipping of exon 53 in the DMD gene. So the 53 exon, if it has premature stop codon, and if you skip that, you will escape the premature stop codon and the translation will continue. Although you don't read a certain part of the dystrophin, but still it is better than having no dystrophin at all. Okay, so because of these reasons, we decided to take the antisense oligonucleotide approach for our idea. So we tested our idea in beta globin mRNA, which is the technical name is HBV mRNA. This is the start codon, and we made this particular construct. This is the start codon, and we introduced a premature stop codon at 16th position. So this is normally there is UGG, and we converted it into UAG. We chose this because by an Indian patient, this mutation is frequently found. And this construct is known as HBBW16 star. HBB stands for the mRNA. W is the amino acid encoded by the 16th codon. And the star is the stop codon. That means we have converted a sense codon into a non-sense codon at the 16th position. Okay. And there is a coding sequence for GFP, or green fluorescent protein. And if we see translation read-through across this premature stop codon, you will see there are green fluorescent protein and therefore fluorescence. Remember, this doesn't have any start codon. So the translation of GFP completely depends on the translation initiation of the HBB. And we use two oligonucleotide, antisense oligonucleotide. One is +1, which binds immediately after the premature stop codon. Another one is +9, which binds 9 mutated after the chemical stop codon. So I'll show the results now. So when we introduce this construct in mammalian cells, this is the result what we get. So the construct without any stop codon, you get, as expected, full fluorescence. You can see the fluorescent cells. That's because this premature stop codon is not there. The translation, there is no obstruction to the translation, it continues to be. But when we introduce this construct which has the premature stop codon, that is HBBW16*, we don't find any fluorescence. However, when we introduce +1 antisense oligo or +9 antisense oligo along with this construct, you start seeing green fluorescence. And this is quantified here. The y-axis shows the mean fluorescence intensity. So notice the +9 antisense oligo, the fluorescence is as good as the construct without any stop codon. That means we were able to achieve the wild type level of beta globin in these cells in spite of having nonsense. The +1 is also effective, but it is not as effective as +9 oligo. The same results I am showing here by Western blot. Western blot is a technique to detect protein. So these bands represent the protein of our interest. And since we use specific antibody, so we know what proteins we are detecting. Also, similar to the fluorescence assays, in this Western blot also, the construct which doesn't have any stop codon, as expected, we get the length protein. But in the construct which has a premature stop codon, there is no band. That means the protein is not made because it has a nonsense mutation. However, when we introduce a +1 oligo or +9 oligo, you start seeing the same protein in spite of having nonsense mutation at 16 codon. So you again notice the +9 oligo, the protein amount we get is as good as the amount we get when there is no stop codon. That means we are able to achieve wild type level of protein in spite of nonsense mutation. And the gap pH shows that there is equal loading in all the lanes. And +1 is not as effective as +9, but still shows some amount of translation. So this is where we are. Our next level is to take this in animal models as well as human patients. So we are looking for collaboration with clinical geneticists because we need cells from patients to show efficacy of our method. So this is the summary. The beta globin mRNA normally makes full length of beta globin protein, but whenever there is a nonsense mutation, the beta globin is not made with the patient. Always have beta thalassemia, require the beta globin transfusion. When we introduce a specific anti-alien nucleotide, we can induce translation breakthrough and we can make full length protein, and probably it will cure the patient at least as long as the oligonucleotide present and making healthy. This part we have published this year in biochemistry, and also we have applied for patent. This is the original application number. So the take-home message from my talk is that antisense oligonucleotides can be used to treat diseases caused by nonsense mutation, and they function making a temporary obstacle for the ribosomes, so that ribosomes make a control or regulated error while reading the stop codon and make full-length protein in spite of the nonsense mutation. So with that, let me thank our lab people who did all the work. So these are the lab members, and we are generously funded by IISc, the DBT, DST, and also primarily by Wellcome Trust DBT India Labs. So thank you all for your attention. And if you are interested in collaboration with the genetic conditions, please contact me. This is my email ID. I'm happy to take any questions you may have. Hello.
Thank you, Sandeep.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sandeep, for this wonderful talk. I'm not sure how many people can actually how many people can actually understand the gravity of or the implication of the research that you have done. I just want to tell the viewers that this is probably completely made in India type of molecule. If we can see that this particular molecule is also working in animal models, we can actually have a made in India molecule for stop codon, premature stop codon mutations. It can help a lot of rare disease patients. I'm really thankful for Sandeep and his team for coming up with this wonderful work. We have few questions, but first I would like to go online, and there is Dilip Singh asking. Dilip Singh from Kolkata, he's a father of 8-year-old Duchenne muscular dystrophy patient, and the child has a point mutation in exon 50, and he's curious if exon skipping would work for him. Any points you want to talk about that, Sandeep?
Yes, I want to know what kind of mutation he has. Is it a nonsense mutation? Is it a missense mutation? And the drug which I talked about is for exon 53 skipping. Yes, sir, please.
Yes, sir, this is Dilip. So the mutation is a nonsense mutation.
Nonsense mutation. Okay. Yeah. Which exon is it?
Exon 50.
50. The drug which they have used is for exon 53. That particular drug may not be useful in your case, but I'm sure there are other people who are working on other exons as well. And also, have you tried Ataluren? Are you aware of the drug?
I'm aware of Ataluren, so I've taken my for the screening also, but they've got certain enrollment guidelines. So he did not get through Ataluren trials.
Okay.
Yeah, so, but okay. I'm pursuing Ataluren. I'm pursuing them, and I've been writing to them. So let's see how it works out. But your presentation, you also mentioned about natural translation. So I did not completely understand, because it was more of a technical presentation. But in terms of having a immediate, I not say immediate, but in terms of having some kind of therapy, upcoming therapy in the future. It was like natural means, do you mean that it's like it's a molecule developed, or it's a molecule readily available naturally?
No. So this is a mRNA which is present in our cell. That's AGO. I'm talking about AGO and mRNA. And this mRNA has two stop coda. Okay. I'll go back to that. Yeah. So you can see that there are two stop codon here, if you see my slide. Okay. So.
Right.
Normally, you expect the translation to stop in the first stop codon itself, but it doesn't happen in all the cases. Sometimes it goes beyond the stop codon. When I say natural, that means it is happening in our cells. We are not inducing, we are not changing. So cell is using some cue, which we don't know yet, or one could be a cell stress. So, and that is causing the ribosomes to ignore the stop codon naturally. There is no treatment, no drug, no human intervention in this. That's why I called natural translation. In the other case, in the beta globin case, there we are introducing out from outside oligonucleotides. So that will be an artificial translation. And the purpose is there, it is therapy. Here the purpose is just to understand how our cells function and how the gene expression is regulated in our cells.
Right, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, I have noted down your email ID, so I'll just get in touch with you if you have any.
Yeah, please contact me. I just want to inform you that we are also working on DMD. We are creating certain mutations which are found in different patients of DMD, and we are trying to develop similar strategies to try and induce translation. But it is still a work in progress. We don't have any solid information on that.
Great, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you
Dilip for asking that wonderful question. Thanks, Sandeep. We have few more questions here. It is offline. So they're asking, you said oligonucleotide, you applied it on the cells. How did the cells, how did you apply? I mean, is it a powder or what is it? How did you apply?
Right. Okay, so we purchased these oligonucleotides from a company. It comes in a lyophilized powder form. Okay. And these oligonucleotides, if you just add in the cell, it will not be taken by the cells, or it will be negligible NP. So we add another transfection reagent called lipofectamine. It's a lipophilic dye. So if you add the oligonucleotides or DNA along with this lipophilic dye, the cells easily take, because the cell membrane is lipophilic, and they easily take, and the oligonucleotides and the DNA enter to our cells easily. But in case of human patients, of course, we can't give oligonucleotide like that. So we will have to inject the bare oligonucleotide in our intravenously or subcutaneously. And people have successfully delivered them in human patients, for example. The two examples I gave, one is nusinersen. The delivery is not a problem in this case because it is well established. The main challenge is to identify a molecule, the sequence of the oligonucleotide, which will be beneficial therapeutically.
Thanks, Sandeep. Another question is, how far actually are we from the therapy? How far are we making it into a therapeutic product?
Okay, I would say very far, because first you have to try it in animal model, and unfortunately the exact similar thalassemia model are not readily available in mice. And that means we have to order genetic mutation in mice and then get them. They're hugely expensive, and we are working on it. And also, once it is shown that mice we can cure the disease, then we will try in patient-derived cells. So the patient-derived cells will have this similar premature stop codon. And in a patient-derived cells, if we can achieve complete or even 50% of translation breakthrough, then definitely we can go for clinical trial. Of course, it's a long time from now.
Thank you, Sandeep. Another question is this particular thing is you said patented. I mean, you have applied for patent. Mm-hmm. How are you looking at? Does it go to the technology transfer office of IISc? Can people approach TTO to?
Yes. They have to approach the IISc IPTL. I don't know the full form. We have an IP intellectual property cell in IISc. All the patents will go through that, because IISc is the inventor. We are just a part of it. They have to approach the IISc if they want to license this patent, in case if the patent is approved finally.
Thank you, Sandeep. One more question does this particular molecule, when made into therapy, will it be useful only for DMD, SMA, or also other brain diseases? You mentioned Rett syndrome and all.
Right. See, this is this strategy can be applied for any condition which are caused by premature stop codon. Even in cancer, some of the cancers, the somatic mutations is present in p53, for example, and there is a premature stop codon, and the p53 is not made in those cancers. So this strategy can be applied to induce read through across the premature stop codon of p53 and make complete p53, and that will take care of the cancer. So I would say any condition which is caused by the premature stop codon will be benefited by this strategy.
Thank you, Sandeep. I think that's all the questions we have. Any further questions we get, we will mail it to you. Mm-hmm. Thanks a lot, everybody, for joining this wonderful session. And again, a word of thanks to our sponsor, LifeCell. Please do join us for the next episode of Care for Rare webinar series. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you all. And thank you already for this opportunity.